And 50% they can also remember what they see and they hear. You might be knowing, you know, model, like we had different tools are there, audiovisual aids are there. And coming to the active learning, 70% they can remember what they say and write. If they are engaged in saying something, if they are engaged in writing something, then 70% they can remember, and 90% they remember what they do. Whenever they do something, whenever they practice something in the lab or any other method during that time, they can know. So in from here we can analyze. So what is active learning strategy and how it engages the students? And I think all of you know about it. Charles Bonneville, who termed the active learning, who coined the term, it was introduced by him. Then what happens? It defines active learning as any learning that involves the learner doing thinking about what they are doing. And active learning is more focused on the cognitive development than the acquisition of facts and transmission of information. Because we have
Hello, madam.
Engage the student. We have to. You have to involve the student. We need to participate in this. Hello, is it audible?
Yes, ma'am. Now it came. Yes, ma'am. Now it came.
Any problem?
In middle, it was break up.
Okay, fine. This is the. You can say, you know, this is the.
Maybe network problem.
Of this virtual platform. Okay.
Yes. Yes,
so
ma'am.
Anyway, let's move to the characteristics. Already we had discussed, it's a learner center. We should not talk because it should not be teacher centered. This should be learner center. We have to think about the learner purpose, extending student skill and idea. Means usually here, the ideas that will be the development involving in higher order thinking. I will talk about whenever I will come to the different methods. By that time, I can tell you how it develops the higher order thinking. Then it engaging in activity. The students are engaged in activity and exploration of their own attitudes, values, and prior experience. Here, the students are usually they use their prior experience when they are engaged in doing certain activity. Then this is the principle which is being given by Barnes. So we have to, when we go to the class, when you think of certain active learning strategy, during that time, we have to go through different principles which are applied. So this is known as, the first one is purposive. Actually, the purposive stands for, we have to know the purpose for what, or for what is the learning objective of this strategy. If we are going to adopt certain strategy, so what is the objective behind it? That should be. Then it should be reflective, because students should, obviously, they should add something from their mind. They try to think and they try to express the thing. This principle, then negotiated means we cannot just think that this is active learning strategy, let the student do everything and the teacher will not do anything. It's not like that. It's a negotiated between the teachers and the learners. That means teachers and the students. Then comes your critical complex. Obviously, I will tell you the learning strategy. It is because it's critical. When we involve the students, all the students label, this is not same at all. So it is really becomes critical for some of the students. So that's why this principle also we have to see. Next, it's a complex. Then situation driven, this is important because we have to sometimes create some situation so that we can involve the students, then finally engage. These are the principles. Then purpose, already I talked about. Develop communicative skill. This is important because when I will talk about the different method like debate, In team-based learning also, somebody has to speak. So during that time, they will develop the communicative skill. Then development of collaboration skills and encourage the students to take the responsibility of the independent learning. That is important here, because these are the purpose of active learning strategy. And here, five keys to build a culture of active learning. This is only because we need to motivate the student. We have to engage the student. There should be a growth mindset. That is important. So these are the five keys actually we have to go for this. So these are the five keys that ownership is there and independence. So we have to build a culture of the active learning in the institution. In this five principle, we have to motivate them, because I will tell you, this is very difficult to adopt many times the active learning strategy. We have to motivate them. You must be knowing, when we are working in an educational institution, if we assign something to the students say, no, why should we do? We are studying in some institution. We are here so that we can study. Teachers are there to feed everything. So we need to motivate them and engage them. And there should be a growth mindset. The student should understand, if I will do something, I can grow myself. And ownership and independence. So these are the key elements for the active learning. And finally, go to the advantage. It increases students' learning interest, motivation, and involvement. Already I mentioned regarding this research which has been there. The students are saying, we are getting bored of the lecture method. That means if we are adopting active learning strategy, then it increases students' learning interest, motivation, and involvement. It allows the students to express ideas, opinions, and practice their skill. It improves group dynamic. How it improves group dynamic? When we are using the team-based teaching, team-based learning, by that time, they improve the group work dynamic, because they learn how to form a group, how to work with a group, how to behave with a group, and how, so everything they learn. So definitely it is improving the group work dynamic. Recognize a variety of learning style. Because when we engage the students, we can also learn many things from the students. Because as I said already, students nowadays, you know, the students, they are, their intelligence, their cognitive level is much developed. So we also, it recognizes a variety of learning style and encourage the students' own style learning also. Because some of the active learning strategy, the student may not find easy. So they can also, we can encourage the student's own style of learning. Then this is in a nutshell about just active learning. It's any method of instruction that allow the students to actively participate in the learning process through a variety of individual and group activity. That means either we can give some individual activity, or we can engage them with the group activity, and in which they can actively participate in the learning process. And in the process, the students are given a variety of ways to interact with each other and complete the activity. What are the activity actually they are being, they do? Collaborative learning, cooperative learning, problem-based learning. I will talk about this. And in the activity, usually we do discussion, presentation, worksheet, games, short reading, short writing, case study, and survey. Then let me talk about some of the active learning strategy. What I just want to cover. Apart from that also, there are lot many active learning strategy which could be applied, which I have not included over here. So team-based learning, problem-based learning, peer sharing, concept mapping, jigsaw method, brainstorming, journaling, gaming and debating, fishbowl technique, think, fair, share, 1 minute paper. I am being told to talk about team-based learning, problem-based learning, peer sharing, journaling, gaming and debating. I just added some of the other methods which could be used in our classroom setting also. So let me start with the team-based learning. So when you talk, yesterday I think we had there was a discussion about this. When we talk about team-based learning, as we know, when we form a team, this is very easy to work. So in team-based learning, what is that? It's a collaborative learning and it's a teaching strategy which enables the people to follow a structured process to enhance the student engagement and quality of student or trainee learning. It's a collaborative learning. Why it's a collaborative learning? Because the teacher and the students both are engaged over here. Teacher is there. Let me tell you this thing. When we talk about active learning strategy, we should not keep it in our mind that only the student has to work. It's not like that. Obviously, student has to engage. Because our main intention to engage the students to learn something so that they can learn something, but the teachers will be there to guide them. So here, it's a collaborative learning that enables the people to follow a structured process. Actually, the teacher is the key person in the team-based learning because she has to formulate the team. She has to guide how the team-based learning will work. There is a structured process so that to enhance the student engagement and the quality of student and trainee learning. And this is the origin. This is the person who talked about first time regarding team-based learning, Larry Michelson. So some of the studies has been done by using team-based learning, and it has been seen that this method becomes very effective. Then principles, let me talk about it. So when we are going for the team-based learning, what principle we are supposed to follow? This is being given by Michelson and Richards in 2005. The group should be properly formed and managed. This part we need to take care of. Group should be properly formed and managed, because whenever we are forming a group, we are forming a team, during that time we have to see, because we have a diverse group. The group diverse in terms of locality, in terms of language, in terms of ethnicity. So whenever we are formulating a group, that should be properly formed. Why we are talking about proper formation? It's not like that, like nowadays we have the students from different parts of India. Sometimes also out of India, we have students. So during that time, we have to mix it up. It's not like that. They are from West Bengal, they are from Assam, let them be a group. It's not like that. So whenever we are doing, the group should be diverse one. And another thing we have to see, there should not be any collision among the group. Because sometimes suppose we are forming a group and our maximum students are from West Bengal, or maximum are from Punjab. So during that time, what may happen? Okay, we are from in one group, suppose three, four, suppose you are formulating a group of seven, three, four people are Punjab. So they will be dominating. So we should not allow all these things. So during the group should be, that's why the first part is group should be properly formed and managed. Then second comes is accountability. Accountability is a very important principle. You must be knowing this thing. Whenever something is being given to the student or something is being assigned to the students in a group, all the individual, they don't contribute equally. But here, the teacher has to look after. Everybody should be accountable to the assigned work. It's not like that the group leader is there, let them work everything, or some individual will do something. It's not like that. Then after accountability, next thing is immediate feedback. Immediate feedback is quite necessary, because if you don't give feedback, because many times I have seen, because I'm telling, I have seen, suppose any team team-based learning that is going on, suppose team is presenting certain things, so feedback is not being given, but this is wrong at all. Immediate feedback to be given, because any problem, suppose somebody is not doing anything, so we have to give. Suppose they are presenting something and suppose they have done something wrong, so we need to tell, no, this part to be corrected, this part to be rectified. The immediate feedback to be given. And finally, team development. Actually, team development, because why I'm saying, when we are using the team-based learning, the research has been undertaken. We formulated team so that student can share their views. So these are the principles we have to take on. Then process. In process, actually, it consists of 5 essential components with an optional last stage, like individual pre-work, then individual readiness assurance test. I'm just telling how the group will be formed. Then team readiness assurance test, clarification session, application exercises, then peer evaluation. Actually, peer evaluation, that is the optional last stage. So I will just give certain example of this. Suppose we just want team-based learning in our classroom setting, in nursing education, and we want any person, because I'm from obstetric nursing department, so I'm just giving the example. I just want that students, team-based learning, I just want to apply the labor, physiological changes in labor, or physiological changes in pregnancy. So what happens? The topic will be given to whole group. It consists of 5 essential components with an optional list. Why? So there is first one is individual pre-work. So we will allow them to go for this. They will study. They will do the individual pre-work. They will just go to the library. They will search the article, they will search from the internet, and they will prepare some of the slides. So that is individual pre-work. Then second comes individual readiness assurance test. Why I'm telling individual readiness assurance test? When second day the students are coming to the class on physiological changes during pregnancy, there should be 10 to 20 multiple choice question depending upon the convenience of the teacher, so that she can administer that question, individual readiness assurance test. Then after that, she has to go through that score and she has to formulate the team. Again, just by format, depends upon the teacher whether she will go for the written test or oral test for the team readiness assurance test. And then clarification session. Let me tell you, here clarification session by the teachers also to be done. And then application of exercises. Team-based teaching, team-based learning is a method. When we are using, we have to go through different phases. And what happens? First, I just analyze, like the teacher will analyze the individual readiness assurance test. Because suppose I'm giving 20 multiple choice questions. Suppose teacher has given 20 multiple choice questions. There may be certain range. Some may score 5, some may score 7, some may score 10, some may score 20. So it depends upon the teacher to form a team. After forming a team, and when she forms a team, she has to mingle all the students on basis of different label. She has to make a score. Then team readiness assurance team. What is the readiness of the team for this presentation? And all the teams one by one the team leader will be there. He or she will come and she will have the presentation. The same topic, only physiological changes in pregnancy. Obviously, the team, they cannot present in the same way. And clarification session will be there and application of exercise.
Hello. Madam, voice is not coming, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello. Kalyani, ma'am. Due to some technical problem, the voice is not audible. Audience, participants, just wait for some time. Hello. Hello, Kalyani madam. Vijayalakshmi madam. Kalyani madam is left or what? Madam, voice is not coming. Screens here also.
I am dialing.
Ma'am, due to technical error, na Jane. Vijayalakshmi ma'am, once please you try to call Kalyani madam. Participants, yes. Please stay tuned. Within 5 minutes, we are
madam
going.
Madam came. Madam came.
Where I am? Because I was just continuing my talk.
Yes, ma'am, sometimes it was going, ma'am. Due to some technical problem, maybe it is going. Participant, madam is there. She will come very, very soon. She will join with us. Hello, Poonam ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, Kalyani ma'am is not coming, ma'am. His voice is not coming, video also not coming. Ma'am is not showing here also.
Yes, ma'am, because due to network connection, I think she might have left. She will join again, madam. So yes, we have to wait for a minute actually.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, again.
Yes, ma'am came. Fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now.
But let me check my internet connectivity.
It's okay. Yes, ma'am, no problem.
Actually, this is depends upon
the network.
The ministry network issue.
Yes. It is only due to network issue. From madam side only. Voice also.
Hello, ma'am. Kalyani ma'am. Hello.
Madam, are you calling my phone? This is the main things. This network is ma'am. In between it is going, coming. Participants, just wait for some time. Due to network problems, maybe ma'am left and she will join very soon with us. Yes, you can.
Is it audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Audible.
Is my slide visible?
No, ma'am, not coming. Not coming, ma'am.
Not coming?
No, ma'am. Not yet.
Okay, let me share again. Is it okay?
It will come. Yes, ma'am, came.
Yes,
okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Can, Can you just tell me where I was when it was not audible? Is faculty commitment?
No, ma'am.
Here I was?
No, ma'am. Processes, it was there. In this slide, you were. Yes, it was. This is the slides we are discussing, ma'am.
Okay.
This one over that previous slide is over this individual.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, fine. Okay, let me go to the faculty commitment. Sorry for this interruption because I have nothing to do with this internet connectivity.
Yes,
so, faculty commitment. Initially, the faculty must invest time to implement team-based learning. And because they are the experts, so they have to form the group, they have to guide the group, and it can be slowly implemented gradually by converting the module into each semester, because this is very difficult to intervene. This is very difficult to adopt because all the teachers may not think about this. And if you talk about student perspective, see faculty as collegial and a part of the team, because the student think the faculty as a member of team, and there is opportunity to develop interpersonal and teamwork skills, professionalism, communication skills, and collaboration skills. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Clearly audible.
Yeah. Then if you go to the limitations, you know, acceptance of change by the teacher, because some of the teacher may think, why should I go for it? Then rigidity in the teacher, then bad team management, personality conflict, inability to complete the curriculum, because, you know, just by using team-based learning, we can't complete the curriculum. Sometimes it becomes very difficult for the teacher, because if you are assigning just to learn what is team-based learning purpose, as all of you know, in the second year, we have CET subject. So in that, what happens, we need a lot many time to do. And if we just actively, we just want to, want to adopt all the students this team-based learning, it will be difficult for the teacher to complete the curriculum. So these are some of the limitation, and also time for coordination and planning. So these are some of the limitation, but still this is a good method which could be used. Then comes problem-based learning. Yesterday also there was a lot many discussion on the problem-based learning. So this is very important. As I said, if I do, I know. So if the problem here, a problem is being given before we expose our students to the clinical, prior to that, we need to orient them with the problem so that they will know in the classroom setting, in the lab setting, whenever the problem arises, how to solve the problem in the real life situation. Is it audible?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm just telling Sashmita, if I will not be audible at certain time, just make me a call. So that
because, yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is the difference. The traditional learning told what we need to know, memorize it, problem assigned to illustrate how to use it. In the traditional world, this is the problem. You just memorize it. Aap ratta laga lo, and when you will go to the clinical site, you just use it. But now, when we talk about problem-based learning, we are assigning problem. If will we just orient the students regarding the problem and identify what we need to know and learn and apply it to solve the problem. Let them identify what they are supposed to know if this kind of problems arises. So if you go to the definition, it's a careful inspection of methods which are permanently successful in formal education, said by John Dewey. Problem-based learning is the basic learning process which allowed primitive man to survive in his environment. Audible?
Yes, ma'am. Continue, ma'am. No problem. Okay.
Problem-based learning is a pedagogical approach that focuses on the learners, facilitates them to investigate issue, combine theory and implementation, and adopt knowledge and ability to formulate feasible solution for specific problem. Please remember, here I'm talking about it focus on the learners. because we assign a problem, the teachers assign a problem to the learners and facilitate them to investigate the issue. They let them investigate the issue. If this is the problem, what I need to do? What may be the complication? So he will apply the theory what he has been learned in the classes, and implementation he has to do and adopt the knowledge and ability to formulate the feasible solution. Because whenever the problem is being assigned, you might be knowing students are just writing down the probable solution what may be there. Then again, they are, after defining the alternative solution, they are just doing certain things which is feasible. So then talking about the features, the characteristics of problem-based learning, it is problem-focused. It is understood, I think, no need to discuss. Number second is the learner-centered. Learner-centered because we want the student to solve the problem. Third one is self-directed. Why it is self-directed? Because we allow the students just to go through different literature and you try to solve the problem. Self-directed and self-reflective. Because if the student has to work, student has to find out what possible solution I have to do with this problem. And tutors are the facilitators. See, these are the features. This is the goals actually. Why do you adopt this active learning strategy or problem-based strategy? Constructive and extensive and flexible knowledge base. Actually, when we talk about constructivism principle, it just means the knowledge from the experience. So whatever the experience somebody is having, she has to apply it when she or he is trying to solve the problem. Foster increased retention of knowledge. Obviously, when somebody is being done by a student, it will increase the retention. It will develop the effective problem-solving skills, develop self-direction, lifelong learning skills, and become effective collaborator. Because when sometimes, you know, we don't assign the individually. Sometimes we can formulate certain groups and we can give certain problem to have a solution. So during that time, he or she can become effective collaborator. Strengthen students' intrinsic motivation to learn. Develop an ability to identify relevant health problems. And reinforce the development of effective clinical reasoning process. Because before you just simply, suppose you have a first year student, before you expose them to the clinical, we are just telling them what are the assessment method, or how you will check the vital signs and all. Then when we are teaching them the nursing process, during that time, we are just telling them these are the steps what you need to follow whenever you will be exposed to the clinical setting. So during that time, we can give we can tell them this is a problem. You had, suppose you are with a patient who is having high fever and he's also having pain and all. So during that time, so we are exposing the students to the problem, fever, high increased temperature, pain also. So during that time, students may think which one need to be solved first and what I need to do. She has to write all the solutions, and after that she can analyze also what solution I need to apply in my patient. So problem-based learning dynamics facilitator will be there. There will be students, there will be problem and solving the problem. Then the principles here, as you know, the student is the focus of educational program. It is the thing we have to see here. Teachers should think that student is the main focus. Tomorrow the students are going to the clinical side. So definitely we have to talk about this. Then learning capacity to be emphasized, ability to analyze, to understand and to solve. Then cooperation principles, development of practical skills and creative thinking skills. This is very important. We are talking about creative thinking skills. When you are talking about the problem solving, let me tell you, in active learning strategy, this is important. We have to develop the practical skills and self-directed learning ability. So these are the principles the teacher has to keep in the mind when they are using the problem solving technique. Then PBL process. So PBL process, already you know how the teachers will take this one, present the problem. Then first thing is that we have to present a problem. These are the Mr. Right now the students are not in the clinical. Students are in the classroom or in the lab. You just tell Mrs. So and so, she came with high fever, she's tailing, she's having loss of appetite and all these things. So you have to present a problem. Then students define the problem and brainstorm the ideas based on the prior knowledge. So whatever the knowledge the student is having, she or he has to define the problem. Okay, what the problem? Though teacher said lot many things when she is sharing, but student has to find out, okay, increased temperature, loss of appetite. So these things, the student has to define the problem. Then student engage in independent study. Then student is thinking, independent studies he is doing. Okay, this temperature, increased temperature, in which case the patient's temperature may increase. There are lot many cases. Maybe infection, may suffering from malaria. Nowadays, all of you know, corona, whatever it may be. So student engages in independent study. Then students share information, engage in peer teaching, and work towards a solution. The student can talk with the peers also. Then means he or she can formulate certain solution. Then student present their solution and review what they have learned. Then student has to present it before the teacher that these are the possible solution. If increased temperature, so I have formulated this many alternative solution. I will apply cold sponging, or I will just maintain the environment well ventilated. Then I can administer some give some medication. So all these solutions she has to present. Then student engage in self, peer and tutor review of the process. Then there will be review whether this problem, whatever is being assigned to the student, the teacher will review. Peer can also review that whether this kind of problem, if it will be given to the students, whether it is being done properly or not. These are the PBL process, problem-based learning. This is just the repetition. I'm just not repeating it. Then student engage in a wide variety of learning experience. Renu madam, can you just tell me how much time I have actually with me?
Ma'am, the platform is yours only, ma'am. Today's session just... only for you only, ma'am. Whenever it will be...
No.
I don't want to make... You can tell so that I can review my talk.
15 time is there. Up to 12, 15.
No, already 12 is already 12.
Otherwise, up to 12:30, you can continue. After that, there question answer session within 5
minutes. Yeah. Okay. I just wanted to know because some of the disturbances are according to that only I will explain it. Otherwise, I won't explain. Okay. I will just tell some of the names. Okay?
No, ma'am. You explained very nicely.
Yes, very nicely you are explaining. So that's why we are not getting bored.
Okay, fine. But too many participants are there. They should not feel bored, at least for that purpose. I just ask. Anyway, okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So when we are talking about problem-based learning, actually students are engaged in variety of way. When we are talking about active learning strategy, we can see when we are using problem-based learning classes, the students, they are using the lecture which they had heard about it. Then also topic tutorials. They are thinking about the practical. Then they are doing personal study. They computer-assisted learning, because whenever, as you know, nowadays nobody wants to go to see a book. Some meaning, chalo, let's type in the Google and let's see. So computer-assisted learning. demonstration, the clinical work, the library skills. So just imagine when we talk about problem-based learning. So we are engaging students in different kind of strategy when they are exposed to this method. Then teacher's role monitors and evaluates the learning and discussion. This is the teacher role. From the very beginning, I said, though we are talking about active learning strategy, it does not mean that teacher will not do anything. So this is teacher's role. They will monitor it. Guidance is giving in the form of suggestion. Because sometimes, when we are setting priority, whenever we are coming, suppose student is coming with 3-4 problem. So during that case, student should know which problem should be given topmost priority. So during that time, student may feel sometimes difficulty. So that's why in that part, student need the guidance of the teacher. And keep the students involved. It is the teacher's role. Manage the group dynamic, because problem, let me tell you here, problem solving, that could be individual, that could be group level. So when it is in a group level, manage the group dynamics, then keep the process moving. Intervene if the students are not working. Already I talked about this in team-based learning, many a times it is being said. Individual level, you know, the students say, okay, see or he is doing, let them do. I will just sit idly, but it should not be. And provide authentic assessment. This is important. Whenever we are assessing the problem, because you know, problem-based learning is a very important method. As we know, yesterday I think madam was saying, the speaker ma'am was saying about it, that our profession is skill-based. So whenever we are exposing to a problem, so we need to be much careful. We have to provide authentic assessment to the students so that they will be equipped with the knowledge and they will apply it into the practice. Then students' role, work in a group of 6 to 8, or they meet for about an hour and a half, 2 or 3 times in a week. Because, you know, sometimes the problem, it's not like that. Today we will give a problem, chalo, come with the solution tomorrow. It's not like that. We have to give them time also. Sometimes if we have given the lecture for a long time period, we may not give them time. But if we have not given any lecture, many a times we give the lecture on that, then only we orient them to a problem. So that's why they have to meet, then analyze, discuss, and generate the question. Then engage in self-directed learning and communicate results back to the group. This is important. Whenever it is a group problem solving is being done in a group level, they have to communicate the results back to the group. These are the advantages. So I think it's just repetition. I'm not going through that. It enhances student-centered learning. It's a lifelong learning. In-depth learning will be done, because whenever the student will do something, as I said, if I will do something, if I will engage myself in some activity, definitely I will have in-depth learning about this. And augment self-learning. Why it augments self-learning? Because student is being given a problem. See, or he has to find a solution. So if see and he has no knowledge at all, they cannot find the solution. So for that purpose, definitely it will increase the learning process. And also there will be development, reinforce interpersonal skills, and higher level of learning is there. Then let me tell about the disadvantages, also time consuming process and traditional assumption of the student. Student might be thinking, why to go for this problem solving approach? Role of the instructor is much more. That may be people's evaluation and cognitive load. So these are the disadvantages. Then let me go to the peer sharing, but I don't know how many of us use this method as active learning strategy, but this is a very good method if we are using. In peer sharing, usually I have seen in some colleges, they ask the senior to source, to demonstrate certain skills to the juniors. That could be peer sharing, but exactly when we talk about peer sharing, what is that? This is peer education, is the teaching or sharing of health information, values, and behavior in educating others who may share similar social backgrounds or life experience. Though it's a definition which is being given, I'm just telling simply how we can integrate into our practice. When our students are there, because when we talk about peer, we can just take the same group students. And we know the teachers are the best evaluator because they know who are sound at what. So usually in when we talk about peer education, student learning from and with each other in both formal and informal way. But let me tell you, though it's a peer education is an active learning strategy, but it is in a very less use at all. But what we can do, the term peer learning remains abstract. Okay, this is not so much of clear. It's a two-way reciprocal learning activity, mutually beneficial and involve the sharing of knowledge, ideas and experience between the participants. It's a way of moving beyond independent to interdependent. I'm telling independence means suppose individual things, individual topics are being given. So I will study, another student will study. So all things are coming like independent. But in peer sharing, what happens? It becomes interdependent. I'm just giving example from my own experience. I usually did it in the last 2-3 years in my lab. Sorry to quote the examples only on the midwifery. I may be excused for that. Because when I'm talking about, pelvis and skull, when I was teaching the students about this, so this is very difficult for a teacher to go through whether the students are well oriented regarding the pelvis parts and all. So what I just made the pair that one student will just go through the all the parts, whether the parts of pelvis, the bones part, the diameter, whatever the outlet and that, or all everything is there. Whether means one person has to talk about all these things, then the second one again will say these are your mistake, that part you have left. Then another one will say. Then when they come back to the class, actually they will just give me the report. So there may be some biasness. So what happens? I just randomly ask the student, whatever they said, whether this is right or not, whether she has really covered that part or not. So in this way also, we can peer learning could be possible, because though it's not being implemented, but it could be possible. And purpose is working with others, because what happens, you might be knowing, this is very difficult for the, sometimes when the students, they feel very shy to ask questions to the teachers, but they are very open to with their students, with the friends. So in that part, peer education, peer learning, you know, that can help. Working with others, then critical inquiry and reflection, because what happens, suppose one student is very good at something, you know, good at mechanism of labor, and during that time, suppose somebody is asking and she's not able to tell the things, so obviously that student will go and look at the library, look at the internet to search the things to share her knowledge. So communication and articulation of knowledge, understanding and skill also important. But let me tell you, skill part is quite difficult in peer sharing. Managing learning and how to learn, self and peer assessment. But then who will be the peer? This is important. As I was talking about from the very beginning, some of the educational institutions, they use their senior to demonstrate certain things. Or sometimes I'm telling, in the nursing foundation lab also, I have seen, I had done also when I was teaching nursing foundation. Suppose today I'm just demonstrating a procedure. From the first group, written demo I have taken, to whom I think he or she is efficient, I can tell them to take the written demo of some other students. So that could be possible also. And that is also one kind of strategy which we can implement. Then who will be the peer? Usually, generally peers are the people in a similar situation. Means they should not be any means what you can say, they share the status as a fellow learners, and they do not have a role in that situation as a teacher or expert practitioner. Means the peer, they should be free. They should not think that no, she is very efficient one, so she is teaching me. So this kind of feeling should not be there. There should not be any power position terms. It should not come in peer education. What's the benefits? It individualized learning, direct interaction between students, promote active learning. Then peer teachers also reinforce their own learning by instructing others. Means this peer, in peer teaching also that could be done. Next is we need to go, that is concept mapping. Concept mapping is a quite higher order means development which is needed. What is concept mapping? Let me tell you. This is a graphical tools for organizing and representing knowledge. You must have seen, I will just give you the example in the last. You must have seen, you know, some of the, what you can say, very flow chart in science. If you go to the DC Datta book, or if you go to the MedSearg book, it is being woven. Very nicely concept mapping is being done. So it's a graphical tool for organizing and representing knowledge. But let me tell you this thing, this is a very, very difficult task for the students. Concept mapping means, because we have a class of 60 or 100 with a different level of understanding. So the concept mapping requires actually very good knowledge, because we have to present the graphical tool for organizing and representing knowledge. It is the individualized technique of summarizing the relationship among different ideas in graphs while engaged in the learning activity. And it is a technique for visualizing the relationship among the different concepts. So conceptual mapping, already I talked about it. This is being introduced by Joseph D. Novak. This is a visual representation of the hierarchy and relationship among the concept within the individual mind. Already origin is being very given. So what is the purpose? To generate idea, because whenever concept mapping integrate brainstorming, I will tell you brainstorming also one of the method. I'm just telling one of the method which is being included in concept mapping is the brainstorming. And also brainstorming is integrated in problem solving method. So here the purpose of concept mapping is to generate idea, to design a complex structure, to communicate complex idea, and to aid learning by integrating new and old knowledge, and to assess understanding or diagnose misunderstanding. Why I'm telling assess understanding or diagnose misunderstanding? Whenever the student will present with a concept map, during that time we can know whether they understand the things in a proper way or not. That's why we can diagnose the misunderstanding about that. Then characteristics, I don't want to explain characteristics, because just simply I'm going to the example so that we can understand properly. Stages in the construction of a conceptual mapping is brainstorming. The first one is your brainstorming. We have to think what, how to develop a relationship among the concept and organizing it. We have to do a layout, then we have to link, again revise, then finalizing. Just see at the example so that we can, you can understand. So this is childhood obesity assessment. How will you do? We can do BMI. This is, let me tell you, actually concept mapping again classified into simple, complex, different kinds of there. I just don't want to confuse you people. So that the simple concept mapping I did. So we have to do assessment. We know that childhood obesity is the main concept. So in that way, how will you assess? We have to assess with the BMI. We have some, what are the complications can occur? Then what are the way to prevent? So in this way, so please remember, concept mapping means what? Suppose I have written childhood obesity. You can think of a topic, diabetes. You can, why diabetes occur? What are the assessment? So central concept will be diabetes. Then you have to give some relationship. Diabetes, if somebody is obese, diabetes may occur. Heredity. So you have to. So that means when you are defining some concept and you are defining the relationship. So that's known as your concept mapping. Actually, concept mapping helps you to understand or helps you to remember the things in a very easy way. And that's why we do use concept mapping. That could be used, but I'm telling, I think very few people might be using. I don't know, because in my knowledge, very few people use. Might be, it may be used in some part of India. I don't have that knowledge. So that's all regarding concept mapping. Next comes your Jigsaw method. I think all of you must be knowing about, all of you must have heard about the Jigsaw method. Jigsaw method, it's a cooperative learning technique which has been proven to increase educational outcomes and reduce racial tension. Jigsaw technique, you know, what happens? It's a cooperative learning in which the student work in small group. The student there may be some doubt which can in the mind of the student. If it's a cooperative learning, team-based learning, sometimes, you know, some learning strategy, they overlap each other. So Jigsaw method, I'm telling, in a problem-based learning, what happens? A problem is being given to the students. In the team-based learning, one topic is being given, like I talk about physiological changes during pregnancy. On same topic, every team will come and say, that is that. But in Jigsaw technique, we just flip the classroom into the groups. I will talk about it. So that origin, Jigsaw technique is invented by Elliot Aronson in 71. Purpose, what is the purpose? Increasing need for interdependence, providing well-defined framework, fulfilling academic and social skill goals. Success of the group depends upon everyone, because here also we are classifying, we're flipping the class into the group. Let me tell you the process so that it will be easy for everybody to understand. Steps in Jigsaw technique and how can we, I have gone through a lot many studies and they have used this Jigsaw technique in the classroom and they found it is effective in effective in the classroom. So in steps of Jigsaw technique, what happens? Divide the students into 5 or 6 person like Jigsaw group. First step we have to do. Jigsaw group we have to make. Then appoint one student from each group as the group leader. Then divide the day's lesson into 5 to 6 segments. I emphasize on divide the day's lesson into 5 to 6 segments. Suppose today I'm talking about minor ailments during pregnancy. So minor ailments, there may be 11, 12 minor ailments. Or suppose my topic is, I'm talking about stages of labor or factors, causes of onset of labor. Suppose I'm talking about causes of onset of labor. So if I talk about causes of onset of labor, so I divide the lesson into 5 to 6 segments, because there are a lot many theory. We have endocrine theories are there, hypothalamus pituitary axis theory, uterine distension theory. So these are the causes. So I will just divide one segment, and that segment will be given to the one group. Step 4, assign each student to learn one segment. And give the students time to read over that segment at least twice and become familiar with it. Then from the temporary expert group, by having one student, actually what happens? One is your Jigsaw group. From, they will go to their home, they will just home study, they will do about it. Whatever the fact causes of onset of labor you have given, they will go through it. Then they will come back. let me tell you, in the same day it cannot be possible. They will you can give them also time, 2 to 3 days time, or you can tell them one day time, one night time is being given. Next day they will come back. Actually, we have to intermingle. Suppose in the group 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so we have to just take one students from one group and we let them join in another group, just have a discussion, then again bring the students back into their jigsaw group. Ask each student to present her or his segment to the group, and during that time float from group to group for observing the process. At the end of the session, give a quiz on the material. Let me tell you here, the jigsaw group also can be used in our classroom. Then teacher's role is very important. Teacher is a backstage designer over here, because teacher has to initiate, teacher has to decide the topic, teacher has to guide how to carry out the activity. So this jigsaw, this is I think you must have heard about it, but this is also of less use at all as per my knowledge. Then comes your brainstorming. Brainstorming, as you know, brainstorming is a method which could be used when you are starting a class. Suppose you start a class of med search and just going to the definition, and I'm just giving the example. I'm not describing more about it. So what is brainstorming? It's a simple technique which can involve an entire class in a discussion. You're just throwing, suppose you are talking, I'm talking about medical surgical nursing. Today I just want to start with the COPD. So before I go to the chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, I just want to start. Before that, I can put some question related to the respiratory system, or what are the common problems. So the student will have a brainstorming, you know, they will think about their previous knowledge and they will tell. That's a brainstorming. Also, you can give them a situation, and you can ask them what are the what are the criteria, what are the complications, what is being previously learned. So I think all of you must be knowing brainstorming, that method. Usually I think we use in a classroom brainstorming. It's a group creativity technique by which efforts are made to find a conclusion for a specific problem by gathering a list of ideas spontaneously. And brainstorming is very important. I'm just skipping all the purpose. It helps in the learning process. It boosts academic performance. It is using previous knowledge. Brainstorming you can do. Suppose you can ask a question and let them think about that and they will answer. That's your brainstorming. Then let me talk about journaling. Yesterday, I think madam was telling, journaling, gaming, debating. These three topics, though it's coming under active learning strategy, we don't use frequently this one. Just I'm telling what is that. One form of journaling is also maintaining diary. Let me tell you, I think that part everybody is doing. Every day we allow the students to write the diary when they go to the clinical side. Actually, journaling is a separate thing. It provokes more reflection and encourage students to take charge of their learning and their feelings. Actually, what is how journaling could be integrated in the classroom, though it's a time-consuming process. You can Saturday, you can keep Saturday as a, including journaling as a method of strategy. And in journaling, you ask the students in the 7 months, 6 days time period, what is her experience? She will write the things. And this is not feasible. Same thing, everybody will write. And it is not feasible for the teacher to go through each one. So randomly she can pick and she can express it, she can share it. So this is your journaling actually. Let me talk about, I cannot tell you the details about, because students may confusing about journaling and journal clock presentation. Journal clock presentation is different than the journaling. Journaling student has to write certain things. journal crop presentation is different, where we are supposed to take one article and we have to present it. That's different. Journaling, usually it helps the students to express. Journaling is a form of writing in its own right. Student can also freely generate ideas for other types of writing as a journal. And it is an activity which can result in one of the most powerful and enduring of learning experience. It's for maybe for both the students and the faculty members. One thing I may tell you, if we are the beginners, we just want to start journaling in our classroom, so we have to be consistent. Be consistent means we have to always, if we have initiated certain things, we need to maintain it. Then we have to give direction how to write. Then use writing prompts. It's not that I went there, everything they will write. They have to be, we have to give them cues. These are the points we need to write. Use free writing. Free writing means they can express. We should not stop them to express. Ye aapko express nahi karna chahiye, nahi likhna chahiye. Let them write. Then review students' work and encourage self-evaluation. So journaling, though it is not being used, it could be used also as an active learning strategy. Then coming to the gaming and debating, I'm just going through the articles. I think I got 6 to 7 articles on gaming only who has used, but I did not find a single article in India, I think. It's all they have used the gaming technique. Actually, on that gaming, they have included also play, role play also they have added. So in gaming technique, like we can give some, I'm not going to this theoretical basis of gaming, just I'm giving example, because as all of you know, we have to create interest among the students. We have to do, like we have to make it interesting, the class, and so that we can engage the student in some kind of game, like searching of words. Suppose I will tell you, write 5 words, like it can be a game also. 5 words start with C, which is related to respiratory disorder. So they will tell all the things. So likewise, also we can use gaming and also puzzles. Maybe there are some puzzle game we can do. So that will help in the also the same thing, effective retention of knowledge. Then gaming is an innovative teaching strategy. The research has shown that this is very effective, because when, you know, gaming means the student think that, you know, it's not a burden for all of us. We are used in gaming. So they will have interest, and definitely when they're having interest, that will enhance the retention of knowledge. Then comes debate. That's also a debatable issue, you know, debate whether it can be used in the classroom or not. For some issue, we can use it, like female feticide. Obviously, definitely, everybody will say no. So we cannot stay. Like debatable topics should be there. That could be like suppose percentage of what you can say. Right now, I think regarding women reservation in certain topics. So debate that stays. But we can. Do certain debating in between the class, so that the student will have some, develop some communication skill. They will have the confidence so that they can present certain things. So debate stays in the class can be effective tools for encouraging students. And debate can vary from simple in class presentation to more elaborate, because we usually, what we do, do the debate as a competition basis. But also it could be used benefits, because when it is in the group, it improve teamwork, increase confidence, improve public speaking, ability to defend an argument. Because whenever there is a debate, actually there are some people who are in the for of that topic, who are in the opposite of that topic. So that these are the skills. There should be analysis skill, evaluative skill, inference, explanation, and self-regulation. These are the skills which are used in the debate. Then coming to the some of the techniques which could be used, and but it's not in common use. There's a fishbowl technique. I think yesterday also madam talked about it. In a fishbowl technique, actually it is used to help a large group of people reach a common understanding on a set of issues or proposals and increase their feelings of participation. Means yesterday madam has also nicely described about it. In a fishbowl technique, actually we classify the group and we just make it into two circle. One is inside, one is outside. Inner group, we find those who are efficient, one, they can talk about a topic, and outer group people, they can just do certain things. They can ask question. Okay, that is the things. Then that is a fishbowl technique that could be used also. Then another one is flipped classroom. Already I talked about this. Flipped classroom also one of the strategy which is used in the jigsaw. Also problem-based learning, also inner-based learning. We are just flipping the class with the different labels. Then we intermingle them. Then they will come back and they will present on a topic. Let me tell you, flipped classroom, team-based learning, jigsaw, these all are interrelated. Then comes think, pair, share. This also, as I talk about brainstorming, when you are asking certain question during that time, in think, pair, share, you just ask certain question, let them be pair, they will exchange their idea, then they will share to the group. That is the think, pair, share group. Then finally, 1 minute paper. I think this is also an instructional strategy which uses a short writing task to assist learner understanding of course material. It is usually assigned with an open-ended question and lasts 5 to 10 minutes. Means just after the class, if it's a 45 minutes, usually we have suppose 1 hour of class. We have to classify into different segment. Then we have to ask finally, before 10 minutes, you just stop the class, ask 5 minutes to be given, write 1 minute paper. I have taken this class, what you learned? So let them express. This is really difficult. Student will write, you cannot assess every day. So once in a time, you can go for the 1 minute paper. So coming to the conclusion, we have different teaching strategy, active learning strategy. I have included few. I have not included knowingly also few because I think that part is being given to different speakers. Okay, so I did not talk about group discussion, role play, some of the clinical teaching method which is being used. I have not gone through. So please, whatever the learning strategy, if I have left, you people are open to share your view regarding that. So I can just conclude you one thing, you know, we cannot just stick to one teaching strategy in our class. We have to integrate different strategy in a class for the students and to engage the students. And finally, I have to conclude this one with the saying, learning is not the product of teaching. Learning is the product of activity of learners. So learning is not the product of teaching. It is the product of activity of the learners. So you know, it's not the what we are teaching. This is not the product. When you do certain things, then only that could be a good learning. So thank you very much, all of you, for the patient listening. I think some of the questions are there. I have to take. Thank you very much for the patient listening. I think some question. Can I just go through that?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for enlightening all the participants on the topic active learning strategies, ma'am. Ma'am has elaborated on problem-based learning, collaborative learning, cooperative learning, maximum types of learning that we all our faculty should follow in the colleges when we are teaching our students. So some of questions, queries are there that our participants were asking.
I'm just going through that.
Yes,
I think one of the student has one of the participant. Sorry, I don't know your because it's a mixed group. So yes, how we can? I think this is the first question. Now, how yes, we can apply in nursing to enhance the level of students' understanding. That yes, is. Means
I the question hope, is not clear.
That's why I wanted to know. Anyway, how can we apply in nursing if you are talking about active learning strategy? Definitely, we can enhance the level of student understanding because may it be a team teaching method, may it be a problem-based learning. If you are actively involved in certain things, so definitely you will increase your understanding level.
Yes, ma'am.
So I don't know whether I am correct and I have rightly answered you or not because your question is not clear. So I hope I have clear.
Ma'am, actually, if it is an active learning method, so if the student is not able to understanding, so we have to follow the different method of teaching.
Yeah, that is the thing.
Yes, ma'am.
Because, you know, we cannot just group, like we cannot just, I told you, we cannot simply say this is the best method. We yes, have yes, to integrate so many methods. So yes, that ma'am, should be. And another one question is there, whether lecture should be taken prior to the gaming for a particular topic? Yes, it could be. Lecture should be taken because, you know, I'm telling, if we are talking about active learning strategy, actually, gaming technique is not being used so frequently. But if you are using, like some words I talked about, word searching is also a gaming technique. So in word searching, suppose you are talking, so definitely the student might have certain idea in the previous classes. So if you're means anybody is saying whether lecture should be taken prior to the gaming for a particular topic, if it's a difficult topic, definitely yes. If it's not a difficult topic, like I'm telling something, you know, because I'm telling, if you are the teacher, you are going to a particular class, you must be knowing that they have acquired this much of knowledge in the first year and taking the second year classes likewise. I hope I'm clear. I don't know because I'm not able to get the feedback. Next one is, please explain jigsaw method with example as temporary expert is not clear. That is, I think they have asked. Actually, the expert are known as jigsaw expert, or we call it them as a temporary expert. Actually, they are not expert in jigsaw method. What we do means we are just dividing them into a group. We think that because we give them time to go through that, and we call them as temporary expert because on that part they will just work on and they will be expert. That's why we are using them as a jigsaw expert or temporary expert. Explain regarding fishbowl technique. I know, actually, I thought that I'm running shortage of time. That's why I was very hurry in that technique. Okay, regarding fishbowl technique, actually, let me tell you, if it is 60 group of students, you cannot take all the 60. Suppose you are taking 30. 10 students, as I said you already, if you are a teacher, you are taking the classes for the students, you must be knowing who is good at, who is good, who is, has different levels of knowledge. You might be knowing the different levels of knowledge. So in fishbowl technique, what happens? Suppose I know these students are very sound at this topic. Like very same example, stages of labor. Actually, let me tell you, fishbowl technique is also one kind of peer teaching. So we will have
Hello, ma'am, voice is not coming, ma'am.
Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Hello.
Voice is not audible.
Network problem may be started once again.
It's not came maybe. Hello.
Hello.
Hello, ma'am. Hi, yes,
actually,
ma'am.
I had again the connectivity problem. Sorry. I need to see the question again.
Yes.
Yeah. So we are in fishbowl technique, I think.
Fishbowl technique, yes, ma'am.
Then regarding fishbowl technique. So we have an inner group, we have an outer group. So inner group is the person who will explain everything. And outer group, they will listen and they will ask certain question. Also, if they know certain things, they can add. Fishbowl technique. How to use jigsaw method in student as a teacher? I told you already, again, I'm telling, repeating it, that suppose, like I talked about, suppose labor. Again, I may be excused, I'm just giving the examples of all midwifery related topic. Suppose labor, I classify, but labor, I talked about, I think, onset, causes of onset of labor. Actually, jigsaw method, you can define one class into different segment, or you can classify the topic into different aspect. I hope I'm clear. Suppose theory, causes of onset of labor I'm sharing. Like I talked about uterine distension theory, oxytocin. Another one is progesterone, estrogen. I'm talking about all this hormone. So if what the hormone works. So one segment, I have given uterine distension theory to one group. I have given hypothalamo-pituitary axis theory to the second group. I have given endocrine theory to the third group. Also some psychogenic theory are there. So I have given psychogenic theory. So what will happen? So I will make jigsaw method. I will not, like I talked to you in the team base, we are assessing the readiness. We are not assessing the readiness in the jigsaw group. Jigsaw group, we just classify the students. It depends upon you whether you will classify the whole class or you will classify some of the students. But if you are classifying 30 students right now, next turn also you have to again classify another 30. Otherwise, they will develop some complex. So as a teacher, you can segment the aspect of a topic and give them one night or 2 days. Again, it depends upon you. If it is completely new, so it is my suggestion, complete new topic should not be given to the students. So whatever is being taught to them, just to have a mastery. So they will go back to the home, they will do some activity, then again they will come back. Actually, one step is there, you know, they will have intermingle of the group. Might be that part difficult, only just to know what they are doing, you know, that part only. So next day they will come back and you as a teacher will go to the different group. And let one of the, like you have to formulate a group leader also, one of the person from the group will come and present it. The same aspect, I'm telling, the aspect, one theory, like psychogenic theory, some group will say, okay? Yeah, sure, ma'am, sure, please. I will be happy. Mercy ma'am has said she can help me. Ma'am, I'll be very happy if you will add, because I just want to learn from you also. So please, you can join. Hello, Mercy ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, join. Yes, she joined, ma'am.
Ma'am, unmute. Please unmute. You have muted your speaker. Please unmute. Ma'am, we are not able. Unmute yourself, ma'am. I think she has unmuted. Madam wants Mercy to ask.
Your voice is coming, ma'am.
Now your sound is coming. I'm
not talking to you.
Now also you.
No, Mercy, ma'am, sound not coming easily.
Not coming.
Madam wants to add something in jigsaw technique. But we are not, no, ma'am, we are not able to hear you. Ma'am, we are not sorry that we are not able to.
Ma'am, your voice is not audible. Ma'am, voice is not at all coming.
So what to do?
Kalani, ma'am, you continue up to that time.
Okay.
Yeah. Again.
Okay, madam.
Yes, now she came.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Came.
Hello, ma'am. I think madam is typing something.
In chat box.
Yeah. Okay, fine, ma'am.
Ma'am, you are muting yourself. Please unmute, you can speak here.
Ma'am.
Hear the mute. And now you can.
I think she is having some voice problem. Means audio problem is there.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, ma'am.
Sorry. I'll just try and explain.
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, there's a lot of disturbance. What we know about jigsaw, when we are doing this method, we divide the class into a home group. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
We, like Mrs. Kalyani said, you divide the topic, any one topic, into various parts. Once the topic is divided into various parts, as a teacher, then we divide the entire class into different groups. Okay, say like four or five per group.
Yes.
And then each of those topics which the teacher has divided the group, each student gets that. So now we have, say example, five home groups with four students in each group. Okay? The teacher will have maybe the topic divided into, say, four, the entire class divided into four. Then each girl in the group gets a separate part of the topic. Like she was using labor. So one person gets oxytocin, the second person gets progesterone, the third person gets whatever. Now the expert group is when
Hello.
Have the home groups with
them again, boys.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Now we hear you.
All right. When we have the home group has now the students are numbered into 1, 2, 3, 4. So the expert group will the various groups get together. So say number one has got methogene and number two has got oxytocin. So all the ones get together and they read up on their topic. So each girl is reading up and they are asking questions only on that topic. The teacher is available in the class. The second, the group number two is the expert group and they will be reading up on oxytocin, everything about oxytocin, right? So they are given 15 minutes. They can ask the teacher, they can refer the internet, they can check their textbooks. After the 15 minutes, each one comes back to their own home group, okay? From their expert group. Once they are back in the home group, girl number one will explain about methogene or her topic to the rest of the group in 5 minutes. The second girl will explain about oxytocin to her group, right? So in the expert group, they all read up and understand that topic the best. Once they come back to the home group, they are explaining. That's why it's called jigsaw method. They go to their different groups. They are there for 15 minutes. They come back and explain to their home group. That's jigsaw method. Is that okay?
Yes,
thank
ma'am.
You. Yeah, thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you very much. We have done this here many times in many classes, and we are putting the students in an active state. So they are actually reading. And one thing you can guarantee is that each student would definitely have learned the topic which is given to her well. That only one you can assure. Because the rest of the people in the home group can ask questions. They can ask questions, they can find out. And the girl, the expert girl, is supposed to be the expert on that one topic. So I think learning is great fun, and our students have had real good feedback. They've given very good feedback from this jigsaw method.
Thank you, okay. Ma'am. Thank you very much for this enlightenment.
Yeah.
Okay. With this, I hope there is also a question, ma'am, to which extent jigsaw method is effective in nursing? As rightly said by Mercy ma'am, it is really very effective, definitely. And also one more question is that in which case we have to use jigsaw method? In which case means whether you are asking about subjects, not clear. If you're asking about subject, I think in every subject you can use it. And another one is how to apply active learning in ownership. I don't get this question actually. Can anybody explain what is that? How to apply active learning in ownership? What is that? Means active learning strategy.
This question also is not clear.
This is a request to the participant. Actually, sorry, I can't
even get. Another question.
Yeah, another question is there. How to develop a good team for any active teaching learning? If you are using a team-based learning, so as I said, we have to assess individual readiness. Let me tell you. Usually, what we do in the class, we form a team. 1 to 5 is a team. We just give certain topic, come back and do certain work and present. Each group will do. But when you are using really a team-based learning, if you want to develop a good team, before that, on what topic you select, you have to select on what topic you want to use that team-based learning. The same thing, suppose a pathology, you just want to certain aspects of pathology you want to tell. So before that, now you have to give them some that topic that on this only we will develop a team-based learning method. And on that, we have to assess the individual readiness by giving them questions. And after that, we have to formulate a team. I think I'm clear about it. Madam, if you want to add something, please add. So this good team depends upon the teachers over here. By taking certain test, they can develop a team. I hope all the questions are answered, or any question, or can you advise which methods are more useful for PG students? Obviously, all the methods. I hope, I think it was a question. Can you advise which methods are more useful for PG students? Obviously, team teaching, then your problem solving method, brainstorming, jigsaw technique also we can use. Most of them, which one best we cannot say. Maximum methods we can use for the PG students. And also for the PG students also, what I did not mention, I think explain clearly, it's about journal club presentation. That is also one of the active learning strategy method, project-based method that could be applied over for the PG students.
Yes, ma'am. Based on the topic and based on the situation, we can select the method, not on PG student like that, we can
Is there any more question? Yes.
No, ma'am, it's over now. Yeah. No more questions.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much, Kalyani Ratham, madam. It was very explainable and it was very nice session. Maybe all the participants are clear their doubt that you are glorify our session. Helen Keller, that thing, a well-educated mind will always have more questions. So that is why today's participants are educated more about our active learning strategies. So that is why they asked more questions. Thank you, ma'am. Really? Thank you so much. Without taking more time. Yes, Vijayalakshmi, ma'am.
Really, today we are discussing more innovative methods. That's yes. Why the more questions is coming. Actually, yes. All the traditional methods we know somehow, some about, but if there will be more discussion, it will be more clear. We are learning from each other in this factor.
Yeah, definitely. Because some of the techniques, it is very difficult for all of us to explain the techniques what we are not using. Like Jigsaw method, I'm telling.
Yes.
And
yes,
moreover, the, yes. Like we are talking about concept mapping, gaming, all these things, journaling. We don't use at all. Baseball technique.
No, concept mapping, somehow we are using
mapping,
but we don't know that is concept mapping because we are only putting mark only, flowchart only, we are doing that.
Yeah,
we are not understanding that is concept mapping.
Yeah, that is the thing. So, this is active learning strategy, we are talking about it, but we usually use very less.
Every college
is not following, like ma'am is following.
Yes, Jigsaw method.
Yes. Everything as per my
One second, the network only will start.
I'm in some meeting and say, okay, let me stop. Thank you very much, NDAI, for giving me the chance to share the knowledge and to learn something from everybody.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am. We also learned so many methods that we can follow in colleges, in our students, among our students. They're not following one or two or three methods like that. Every methods we can follow. So maybe all the participants, those who are participated, if faculties are participated also, they may be clear about all the methods of the active learning strategies. And that Google Guru and YouTube methods will maybe hamper here, that students will not follow about that Google Guru and YouTube methods. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your nice explanation of every questions. Thank you, Mercy, ma'am, also, that she explained that Jigsaw methods is very nicely. And we got so much of knowledge from this session, today's sessions. So again, I am thanking you to all the NTAI members, those who have given us chance to continue this webinar without any network problems. I am requesting to Vijayalakshmi ma'am, our state president, she will say some things and we have to wind up our session. Thank you once again to everybody.
Informative session. Thank you, Kalyan ma'am, and those who are the participated today. And now, actually, the host is the NTI India. So, Poonam ma'am, hello. Hello, Poonam ma'am.
Hello. Yes, ma'am.
Shall we stop the session for today?
Yeah, we can adjourn the session today. Thank you, Kalyani ma'am, Mercy ma'am, and all the respected members over here for today's webinar. Thank you for all the participants for their continuous patience. As they have learned the new technologies, what we can use for the newer teaching methods so that our students could not get bored. So thank you very much. It was a wonderful session. Have great time. See you tomorrow on the same time. Okay, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.